morning and welcome to First Presbyterian. Please join me in the welcome and call to worship. We worship the God who wants his people to be happy. The Lord provides us with multiple reasons and opportunities for happiness when we follow his laws and ways. We'll open this morning with, O Lord, you're beautiful. Please feel free to join along.
Recognizing that we are easily swayed by the wrong advice and that we have strayed from the ways of the Lord, let us confess our sins to God with the hope of finding love and mercy. Let us together pray. God of wisdom, forgive our foolishness. We desire what we do not need and corrupt our relationships with envy. You urge us to gentleness, but we stir up conflict. Give us your grace that we may harvest righteousness and peace for the sake of Jesus Christ, our teacher. Amen. Charm is deceitful and beauty is vain, but the people who fear the Lord are to be praised. Since the first Pentecost of the Christian era, we know we can lead Spirit-filled lives by God's grace. Enabling me to speak and act as Christ would have me, and thus represent him to this present generation. Spirit-filled lives show forth fruit. Fruit as evidence of God's love. And the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Without leaving your seats, if you want to send a signal of greeting and peace to those that can see you where you are, please do so. Looks like some of you are doing the chicken dance. Thank you. Please be seated. No, don't start. Thank you. Please be seated.
Good morning out there. Just one quick announcement that we're going to start Sunday school next week. So if you would like to join us for Sunday school, when you come to church, we're going to go right downstairs to tumble in, okay? So we're not going to come in the sanctuary so that we can kind of stay separate from the adults. We're going to go right downstairs. And if any moms and dads want to bring their kids for the first time, reach out to the Facebook page or the church and we can give you all the details on, you know, what's going on. All right.
Are we going to bless backpacks next week?
We'll talk about that. Yeah, I think so. Sorry. We'll also do the blessing of the backpacks next week, too. So
I just wondered where we were going to do that. Are you sending me to tumble in, or are they going to come up here?
We'll figure out the details.
We'll figure the details.
Okay, Pastor Allen and I will figure out the details of blessing of the backpacks. But when you come to Sunday school next week, bring your backpack so that we can bless it for a great new school year, okay? Okay. Now, the children's sermon. So, how many of you guys have flowers at home? Whether they're plants or maybe in a pot or... Right. So, how many of your plants look like this? No, mine don't. Little side note, I stole these from my parents because most of my flowers look like this. Okay, wilted, not so good, right. Okay, so what do plants need so that they look like this? Water, yes, they need some sun, they need dirt, right? They need somebody to take care of them all the time. So we're kind of like plants. We need sun, we need nourishment. So what are some kinds of nourishment that we need? Food, water, love, exercise. Most importantly, we need God, right? So God is good for our soul. So he's kind of like, pun, a little food for the soul, a little soul food, right? Okay. Well, in today's scripture lesson, it's taken from the book of Psalm. And we're going to hear that people who are happy and delight in the Lord, they're like trees planted by the streams of water, which yield their fruit in its season, and their leaves do not wither. In all they do, they prosper. So we have to remember to follow God's rules and we will look like this, right? Not like this. So let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you for going into our souls and feeding our souls so that we can look like the beautiful potted plants and not the ones that are withering and brown and not so great. Thank you. Amen. Thank you. Today's lesson is taken from the book of the Psalms, Psalm 1, verses 1 through 6, which you will find in your pew Bible in the Old Testament, page 849. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Happy are those who do not follow the advice of the wicked, or take the path that sinners tread, or sit in the seat of scoffers. But their delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law they meditate day and night. They are like trees planted by the streams of water, which yield their fruit in its season, and their leaves do not wither. In all they do, they prosper. The wicked are not so, but are like chaff that the wind drives away. Therefore, the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord watches over the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
I want to begin by thanking the number of you who took the time Sunday and through the week to tell me how much you appreciated last Sunday's sermon, and several of you went so far as to say it was the best sermon you ever heard me give, which means, I am sorry to tell you, it's downhill from here. I can't keep that level up. So pray for me, if you would be so kind, because I'm shaking in my shoes with the pressure of the thought that I've already given my best sermon. That said, happy is as happy does. Isn't that a weird title? I agonized over that. Happy is as happy does. I'm looking especially, but it's so short and to the point, I could recite the entire psalm. But we're looking especially at verse 3. They're like trees planted by streams of water, which yield their fruit in their season, and their leaves do not wither. Megan, that's a really sorry excuse. You need to work on your plant skills. And their leaves do not wither, and in all that they do, they prosper. Anybody here not see dollar signs when I said that last sentence? Oh, you're going to be a lot of work today then, because it's not about money. They are like trees planted by streams of water, which yield their fruit in their season. Their leaves don't wither. And in all that they do, they prosper. They succeed. I wonder if you intentionally sat down with your child at some point in their lives, preferably on the young side, not waiting for their Sunday school teachers to teach them this, and decided to begin to nurture their faith by introducing them to God and explaining who God is, what he says, what he does, how he acts, what he wants to give us, what he wants us to give him. What did you do to start what theologians now call Christian nurture or disciple making? What would your first lesson be? What would you talk about to start the process, to grab their attention? I had an inspiring youth because of all the promise that he had in the Denville church back then when I was there. And he is now a teacher at Morris Knowles. I don't want to give his name away, so I'm not going to tell you what he teaches or how he teaches, except to say that when we got together the week before he had his first class at Morris Knowles, he said, I'm really struggling with what I'm going to say to capture their attention. What experiment I'm going to do that's going to dazzle them and reach out to them and say, I want to hear what else Mr. So-and-so has to tell me. for the next 8 months, 7 months. He said, if I don't do that, they won't listen to anything I say for the rest of the year. Gotta get him now. Gotta grab their interest. Gotta pique their curiosity. Gotta give them something to think about that turns on the aha light and makes them hunger for more. Makes them come to class tomorrow or the next day, expecting that there's going to be something else new and fresh and thought-provoking and that answers my questions about the subject. And I'm thinking to myself, boy, you're putting a lot of pressure on yourself. But you know, speaking to him after the first week that he taught, he pulled it off. And they stayed in rapt attention as I stayed in contact with him throughout his first year. In fact, they still do that. And I'm not surprised. He's an engaging young man. He would have made a good preacher. Didn't feel called. Where would you start to explain to your child who God is and what he wants to do to them and through them in the course of their lives? Would you start with the nativity of Jesus? We often do. It's easy to teach. It's easy to illustrate, whether it's the creche on the mantle or in front of the Christmas tree, or it's the carols that we sing, or don't you just love Luke 2? And a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world would be enrolled. That's the old-fashioned fancy for taking the census. All the people would be enrolled. We'd know who they are and where they are, so we could go send the IRS after them. No, that's not Luke 2, is it? I don't think so. Some of you look worried that it is. Would you start there? Would that be the logical place to grab your kids' attention? What about Matthew 4, Jesus' baptism? Jesus wasn't a baby. Our kids were babies when they were baptized, most of them. Would they even make the connection? We'd have to work at that, wouldn't we? But then there is the number one reason to know about Jesus' baptism. When the heavens opened up and God's voice was heard, "This is my son, whom I love. With him, I'm well pleased." That's what Jacob was looking for from his father when he stole his birthright from Esau. He wanted his father's blessing. He wanted his father to say, he wanted to hear the tones and the inflections and the affection and the affirmation of his voice. "You're my boy. Boy, am I glad I have you." Of course, Esau wasn't too happy about that, but that's another story. You could teach that, but I don't think that's a good beginning place to talk to your kids about God. What about first chapter of Mark? Jesus says, "I will make you fishers of men. Come, you and you and you and you, follow me. I will make you fishers of men." They were already fisher persons. Hard work, baked in the sun, skin tough as cowhide, washed with salt, Is there salt in the Sea of Galilee? No. Gotcha. Or did I? You're just being polite. What about Jesus turning water into wine? I think that works better with adolescents because they're thinking about that stuff then. But I don't think I'd start there with a six-year-old. And if you started by talking about Hawaiian punch, it would be a lot of work to make that connection work for them. But that's what wine was in those days. It was a common drink, been filtered and purified to the point where you didn't get sick from it. Couldn't always say that about water. Would you jump in at the empty tomb with Mary in hysterics? If you know where they've taken my Lord, would you please tell me so I can go get him and fix him and finish preparing his body? See, preparing a body was important because the oils that they massaged into the skin helped the skin decay in an orderly fashion in such a way that nothing would be left in short order but the bones, and the bones then go in a box. And a new, fresh body goes into the tomb for the process to begin again. So they recycled the tomb all the time. But once your bones were in the box, you were done. Where would you start? What would you tell them first? What would hook them? What would they grasp and understand and give them an appetite and a desire to know God better? To know more of Him? To not groan the next time you invited them over to the kitchen table and sat them down and said, "We're going to talk about God again today." Oh, boy. My kids came to me as junior highs, as adolescents, and they didn't want to hear about that stuff at that point. They were more interested in girls and alcohol than they were about God. Don't think that didn't give me a tough job. Of course, I wish I had handled it better, talking to them about God, than I did. After all, I'm the minister. I'm supposed to know everything, right? Where would you start? Where did you start? Did you ever start, or did you always leave it up to the Sunday school teachers? I know Megan's good, and so is Kristen, but hey, come on. They're your kids. For they were. They're now grown-ups, and you can't tell them much now. They're like trees planted by streams of water which yield their fruit in its season, and their leaves don't wither, and in all they do, they prosper. The ungodly are not like that. They're like chaff which the wind drives away. I won't, but I could talk to you about Psalm 1 for days. You know why? Because in spite of having a mom who taught me how to pray and prayed with me every night for years, in spite of having a grandmother who every time I went to see her on Saturday, she was an invalid. I was taken into her room, and she would open her Bible and read a story and explain it and discuss it with me and make sure I understood the meaning of it before we moved on to our next activity, which is usually tossing a bean bag back and forth. They didn't have those pieces of plywood on an angle with the three holes that you toss the bean bag into like they do today. I had lots of people trying to pass the faith on to me. By the way, I was blessed to be befriended when I was still a youth by the director of education for the Presbyterian churches in New Jersey. Her name was Miriam, or Mim Jones. And over and over and over again, she said to anybody who would listen, faith is not taught, it's caught. Bad timing for the cough. Faith is not taught, it's caught. Which really means that you not only have to talk about it, you have to live it. And live it in such a way that your children want to be like that. Want to be like you when you're being faithful. Now, where things really started to go to work for me in my faith development was when third grade at Hillside School in Livingston, New Jersey, when Mrs. Dickert, a good Baptist woman, we still read the Bible before we did the flag salute in those days, Mrs. Dickert made us memorize the 23rd Psalm in what to her was the only translation of Scripture, the King James. Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seats of the scornful. For his delight is in the law of the Lord. And in that law doth he meditate day and night. He's like a tree planted by streams of water, which bringeth forth their fruit in its season. Their leaves don't wither, and whatsoever they do, they prosper. The ungodly, the wicked, all those guys that mentioned and referred to in the opening sentence, not so. They're like the chaff which the wind blows away. Therefore, the ungodly will not stand in the judgment. They're not going to make it through. Nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. Sorry. Seats are full. No standing in the aisle. The way of the righteous. That's where you want to be. Growing up in the 50s, when my congregation was still fighting over the RSV versus the KJV, all the Sunday school teachers still taught us the King James. And that's what we heard in school every morning. And so what little of Scripture I've memorized, considering the 66 books and the number of verses that are there, are indelibly singed into my memory in the King James translation. I think Psalm 1 is a great place to start because it gives you reason to have an appetite to want to know what God's law is. Oh, excuse me. Let me translate that into 2021 words. What God's way is. The way God wants us to live. But the law, if you want to talk about the Decalogue for a minute, that's the Ten Commandments, if you need that translation. Moses brought the Ten Commandments down because God wanted us to know how to live in a healthy way that would make us happy. He did not give us those rules so that we would please him. He did not give us those 10 so that we would give him, by obeying them, honor, respect, notoriety, sense of satisfaction. Every one of those 10 laws are designed, if we would keep them, to make us happy. 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 Coffee's pretty important to Americans. You know that? The pursuit of happiness, we feel, is a divine right. If we don't remember any of the rest of the Declaration of Independence, we remember that. Because it gives us the feeling that we're entitled to be happy. Entitled? Happy is as happy does. If you're not doing your part, you ain't gonna be happy. And it's nobody's fault but yours. I didn't look at you for any particular reason at that instant. You just happened to fall into my view. Look how happy she is. Yes, more translations. And we only had two to worry about in the 50s. Now we have a dozen, if you can even keep track of all of them. Most of them translate out of the Hebrew word in Psalm 1, blessed. Blessed is the man who walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. Blessed, or blessed. It's a good translation. I didn't look them all up, but I know because I'm familiar with TEV, today's English version, a special translation that was created in the 60s, the early 60s, for people for whom English was a second language. It is a very clean and simple translation. You can comprehend anything in TEV if you can read at the third grade level. And at least in the 50s, most newspapers didn't start until the fifth or sixth grade level, except for the comics. Dick Tracy and the Crime Stoppers text box, right? Or Archie and the soda shop. And all the rest of them. Blessed. And we don't really understand that word because we don't use it. And we don't use it because we don't understand it. And we make no effort to go find out about it. But you would naturally come to understand it if you were following the wisdom of Psalm 1. Blessed is the one. And blessed should ring in your ears if you know Matthew 5. You all memorized Matthew 5. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are the meek. Blessed, 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 blessed. All these ways that we might live actually bless us. The end result being happy. And guess what? Matthew 5 is written in Greek, and it's translating that one word in Greek, which I don't even bother to try to pronounce for you. I'm not good at it anyway. Not only as blessed, but as happy. Go back to the TEV. Happy are those. Happy, 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 happy. Isn't that what you want your kids to be? Happy? Isn't that why you doll them all up for Halloween so they can impress the people whose doors they knock on so that they might get a bigger fistful of candy? Isn't that why you used to take them up to Lake Apacon in the summer to go swimming so they'd be happy? And got on their first bicycle, and you had to teach them how to ride it, or they wouldn't be happy. They'd be all scraped up. Happy, happy, happy. We just want our kids to be happy. God wants his kids to be happy too, and that's all of you. And the best way to get there is to follow his ways, to know his laws in depth to the point where you understand the benefit to you of obeying them, the blessing to you of obeying them. Like I said, God gets nothing out of it. You know, he's had a good day whether we obey or not. The thing is, though, like any parent, he wants us to be happy. So I guess we probably make him sad when we don't follow his ways, when we don't dwell on his laws, when we don't run them through our minds again and again. We don't study his word, so that we don't resonate with them, the rules, the ways, to the degree that we fully understand them, that you don't need me to tell you that the poor in spirit has nothing to do with depression or low self-esteem. It has to do with not being full yourself. Remember that weirdo back in the 60s? Johnny Carson got him married on his late night TV show. Really weird guy. What was his name? He wrote his own wedding vow for that ceremony that took place on the Tonight Show. And that's the first time I ever heard the phrase that not puffed up. But he was saying, I'm not going to be full of myself. I'm not going to let my feelings about me dominate my thoughts to the exclusion of thinking about and loving you, Vicky, or whatever the heck her name was. You all went to bed too early to know Johnny Carson anyway. If I wanted to see my father, I had to stay up for Johnny Carson, because that's when he came home. We'd watch it together. He played the banjo. Tiny Tim. Of all the people in the room, I would not have thought you would be the one who knew his name. Yes, it was Tiny Tim and Miss Vicky, right? Good grief. It was Johnny Carson's low point, in my opinion. Wow. Being happy takes more than playing the banjo. Takes more than not being puffed up, but you're on your way. Oh, yes. God's ways, God's laws are written for our own well-being, for our own happiness. But you do have to dwell on them, don't you? You do have to meditate on them. You do have to study them. You do have to talk to other believers about them in order to see the upliftingness of obeying them or following them. I like following better. I don't like the idea about having to obey. Who wants to obey? Especially if you're a little boy. It's much more fun not obeying. As long as you can outrun your mother. Happiness is as happiness does. We, if we're going to teach our children or grandchildren who God is, what God wants to give us, what God wants to receive from us, we have to live that happy life. Not the false smiles, but the genuine being at peace, being able to handle everything in stride, always knowing God is there, always turning to him. Who in your life when you were growing up and you would bring up something that was of great concern to you and they say, wait a second, let's pray about this? Was there one person in your life who did that for you? Two? Three? If not, you probably didn't know how to do it with your kids. Never occurred to you. And this sermon is not here to make you feel bad about how you brought your kids up. Besides, it's too late for that. They're up. They're done. They're out of the oven. They're full baked. They're done. God can use other people to bring them into a relationship with Him. But we just want them to be happy. It occurs to me, too, having built a church from the ground up and having landscaped the property, all 3 acres, I got into planting trees, not me literally digging the holes, but selecting where they were going to go and which ones they were going to be. And I had a row of Crimson King maples, that's the red leaf maple tree, usually pretty full of leaves in season. They're beautiful. And in a line, a sweeping line, they kind of take your eye and guide you, in this case, up the driveway to the bright white building at the end of the driveway. And across the front of the property, from the driveway south, I thought I would do something for variety that would enhance all the trees, but make the red ones stand out. So I planted regular old maples. The problem is, the driveway and Hope Road, the street, formed two sides of what became, we had to dig it out, a rainwater runoff retention pond. Anybody know what a rainwater runoff retention pond is? It's a place where you pipe the water so it doesn't flood the neighbor's basement or yours. And it lets it sit until it percolates down into the ground, assuming the ground is not already saturated. And I did all of this planting, made all these decisions, chose all these trees and their locations, and there were many others, with the help of an arborist, which I thought was pretty smart of me, going to somebody who knew more about trees than I did. And he thought it was a great idea. Green ones lining the street, red ones lining the driveway. What he didn't tell me, and what I didn't learn until I watched it as the trees grew, the green leaf trees don't put down much of a taproot. Their roots are horizontal and they stay pretty close to the ground. And after it began to happen and the roots were visible lying on the ground, I began to remember walking on campus at Bloomfield College where they had these big 4x4 foot pieces of slate that they put end to end to form the sidewalks we walked on. And then they planted maple trees alongside them. And guess what the roots did? That's right, they buckled all the seams so that you were tripping. You had to watch where you put your feet or you were going to have your chin buried in stone. So I guess their arborist wasn't very helpful to them either. But I was pretty unhappy with our arborist because around the edge of the rainwater runoff retention pond where we planted this row of green leaf maple trees, there was a grade. And the water ran down when it rained and into the flatland. It ran away from the trees. And the first year, the trees looked brown by fall. The second year, they only had half as many leaves. And by the third year, they were all dead. Planted by streams of water, they were not. showing forth their color and their life they did not. A waste of money to the people I talked into donating them, they were. Nobody ever challenged me, that I recall, on my choice of those green leaf maple trees and where I chose to have them planted. Because I had a design in mind. I was not thinking agriculturally. I do now. In fact, I haven't planted a green leaf maple tree since anywhere. That's because I also cut the lawn at the new church. And that little tractor did not have a good time getting anywhere near the trunk of those maple trees. But the rocky road that I had to traverse, otherwise known as the roots along the surface. Yes. Planted by streams of water. Planted by the source of life. Planted by that which nourishes and refreshes and enables us to live a full and rich life and give evidence. That's what fruit is, evidence. You know that thing we say right now, we're almost done with it for this year, about the fruits of the Spirit? That's the evidence of the God life that we were created to reflect. There were trees, by the way, this is running longer. There were trees on this property on the edge of some woods, which I was told were golden, delicious apple trees. But that fruit was rotten before it fell from the tree. And I picked one up while I was mowing over that way one day and took a bite out of it and spewed it from my mouth. It was nasty, bitter. Might as well have been drinking vinegar. And then we got a company in that knew how to, without using harsh chemicals, knew how to fertilize the property. And the water from the fertilized section of the lawn ran off into the edge where those golden delicious apple trees were. And one day I'm in the kitchen and one of the kids comes in the door and they're munching on a golden delicious apple. I said, "Where did you get that?" He said, "There's a whole bunch of them out on the lawn." I said, "You're eating those? They're horrible." He said, "No, they're delicious." I said, "I know, that's the kind of apple they are." Smart aleck kids, where would they get that? Oh yeah, me. So I went out and I picked one up, brought it in, rinsed it off under the sink like my mother taught me, bit into it. It was succulently sweet. Oh my gosh, that was the best golden delicious apple I ever had. I picked up a big bowl that I usually put popcorn in when we were watching a movie, went outside and filled it beyond the brim. And then I did a very selfish thing. I told the boys not to tell anybody in the congregation that we had the best apples in town because they'd be gone in a heartbeat. Yes. Trees and God's children need to be nurtured and nourished with the things that give life its color and its sweetness and its purpose, that they might be happy. Had enough? I've had enough. I don't care that there's three more paragraphs. You got it. I can tell. Yeah, stop saying thank you. You can tell. Be blessed by being happy God's way. Amen and amen. You and I have been made capable of being good stewards of what God has given us. So let us, with gratitude in our hearts, give from what has been given to us by God's grace. our great gardener. We are like trees planted by streams of water that yield their fruit in season and prosper in you. We are grateful for all you have provided, and we dedicate our first fruits to you and to the work of your church, now and forever. Amen. Thank you. Please be seated. Megan.
Okay. Two really quick announcements. Again, next week Sunday school starts, so we can't wait to see all of the kids back in the church, not in the sanctuary, and also bring their backpacks so that we can bless them for a great school year. Second, we are going to start collecting for Operation Christmas Child shoeboxes. The collection week is November 15th to the 22nd, so we'll be starting collections next week all the way through November, sometime that week. October, we are going to ask for people to donate clothes, socks, underwear, shirts, shorts. So far, all of our shoeboxes have gone to warm weather climates, so right now you'll get clearance on all the summer stuff, which is perfect for us to add to the shoeboxes. And the age ranges for the shoeboxes are 2 to 14, so just keep that in mind when you're shopping. Okay, now joys and concerns. Prayers for all the health care workers as they continue to work tirelessly taking care of patients. Give them the energy and strength to continue. Prayers for those who have had reactions to the vaccine. May they recover quickly. And prayers for your healing hand on those who are ill. Prayers for our community. May everyone be blessed and that we return to September 12th. Okay. Prayers for Clara's daughter, Amy, as she recovers from surgery. And the flowers this morning are in memory of Sylvia Valentine, given by her family. Okay, the birthdays this week are Anthony Valentine, Devin Valentine, and Peg Schuler. And our individual prayers for the week, are for Alice, Angel, Allison, Andrew, Armando, Barbara, Benjamin, Bruce, Christine, Catherine, Claudette, Darlene, David, Debbie, Diana, Donna, Dawn, Eddie, Ellen, Florence, Gary, Gabby, Gina, Helen, Jay, Jonathan, Jody, Joanne, John, Jasper, Joe, Karen, Kim, Keith, Kyle, Kathy, Larry, Linda, Lorraine, Lily, Morgan, Nancy, Nushabi, Naomi, Owen, Peter, Pat, Paul, Shayla, Scott, Sarah, Steve, Ted, Rick, Richard, Tony, Walter, and Wayne.
Thank you, Megan. We believe so, we pray. Loving God, it is our desire that we too walk in your ways and keep from foolish compromise with the world system. Keep our hearts set on the Lord Jesus, so that our thoughts are not influenced by the mindset of this current age. But may we be like the person planted by your many rivers of grace and love, joy and peace, so that your mercy and compassion may flow through us to the people around us in the places where you have planted us. In the meantime, watch over our nation and world with all its divisions, our health, with all our differences of opinion on medications, precautions, and treatment. The youngest among us, as they head back to school, not yet cleared for antiviral medication, even if their families wanted them protected. And help us to care more deeply about the needs of others than we do about our own needs, as Jesus repeatedly commanded us to do and, by his example, showed us to do, bearing much fruit. We continue to pray as he taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. closing, I want to say thank you for being here. I don't know why. I don't say that more often. Every time I stand and look at all of you, I feel that way. So I say to you, and should say to you more often, thank you for being here. Our chief end is to glorify God and enjoy Him forever. Glorifying God begins with our worship, but does not end here. And while it is good to keep that in mind on a daily basis, it is equally important to remember to enjoy Him. Enjoy Him in both this life and in the life that is to come. Amen. Thank you. Please be seated for the postlude.